Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Berean Baptist Church, this here in the heart of summer. And we're glad that in the heart of summer, you decide to bring your hearts into the house of the Lord today. Amen. And we're going to start by singing, "So Glad to Have You Here." We're going to stand together because we've got to make footprints here, or maybe we've got to follow footprints here. Brother Jim's going to lead the song.
All right, 178 in your hymn book, all standing if you can. Footprints of Jesus. 178. Sweetly, Lord, have we heard Thee calling, come, follow me. And we see where the footprints falling lead us to Thee. Footprints of Jesus that makes the pathway glow. We will follow the steps Jesus, where'er they go. Through they lead o'er the dark mountain, seeking His sheep. Or along by Siloam's fountains, helping the weak. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathways glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. If they lead through the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lonely, serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus that makes the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Then at last when on high He sees us, our journey done, we will rest where the steps of Jesus and at His throne. Footprints of Jesus that makes the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go.
Amen. Wonderful singing. We're going to begin in a word of prayer in just a second here. Before I do that, I want to point your attention to somebody's tie. So, Brother Carl, I'm going to come up here. I want to show them your tie real quick here. I want to show you this because, you know, sometimes you think, you know, these tall deacons, they don't have any sense of humor, but he actually does. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to have him turn around and show you his tie. And he's saying, you know, he said it was really hard to text these onto my tie, is what he said. And so he does have a sense of humor. And then the other thing is, sometimes we like to embarrass deacons because today is his 76th birthday, today. And so we're going to sing real quick. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Praise the Lord. And if you text him today, be sure to send him the 76 emoji salute. Be sure to do that. You're going to have to count a little bit to do that. Let's have a word of prayer. Ask God's blessing on the service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come into your house, your place of worship. And Lord, of course, it wouldn't be anything if we were not here. But we are here, and so we pray to you to help us today through your word. We pray that you would help us in our worship of you because you are worthy of our worship. And that you would help us in our lives because we confess before you we certainly need it. Please work in every aspect of the service in drawing us to you. In Jesus' name, amen. And you may remain standing because we're going to sing another song real quick here.
All right, this is our greeting song number 50. There's power in the blood. Sing the first verse and then greet one another. Number 50. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. All right, greet one another.
Good greeting. Oh, yeah, that's it.
Okay, folks, let's get back to our places. Singing number 50. Number 50 on the fourth verse, let's go. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily with praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. Sing it now. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. Oh, Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Amen. You may be seated, but keep the hymn book open to 296. 296 before our announcements and offering. No, not one. 296. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our soul's diseases. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one, no, not one. No night so dark but his love can cheer us. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Did ever saint find his friend forsake him? No, not one, no, not one. Or sinner find that he would not take him? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one, no, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one.
Okay, amen. Very good. Let me first, is there anybody and you need a bulletin this morning? We put out monthly bulletins. This is the July bulletin. Red is the color of the month, and if you need one, just raise your hand. We'll be sure to get that to you. This is usually a test of see how well the ushers did at distributing. And whoa, ushers, you are in rare form today. Look at that. Okay, so then we'll recycle that. But you know what? I sense a mugging is afoot. That's what I sense. And that is, if you haven't visited for us for a while, we have something for you. And so just checking here, Robin, Stephanie, you haven't been here for a little while. Thina, you haven't either, so we're going to take care of this right now. And that is right here, we're going to mug those. You can mug Athena, too, if she didn't get one of these. Okay, Athena, we'll... Did you get one already? Oh, you snuck in, okay. Dwayne, did you get one of these? He did, too. Okay, are we missing anybody else? Looking, Christy didn't get one. Get up here. Christy, welcome back. And Christy was fighting some illness. She's fully recovered. We're grateful for that. Bob and Tracy, what about you folks? Nope, Bob and Tracy, we got to mug you. You've been gone too long. You see, you're gone for 3 weeks. You just degrade back into the visitor category is what happens here. And so anyway, we'll make sure that you get those as well, because everybody knows you don't have enough. You don't have enough beverage mugs. Did you get one, Bob? Say what? We're good. He says, my cupboard's only so full. That's it. He says, it's okay, Tracy. I'm giving you permission to throw Bob's favorite mug away to put that one in right here. I'm in trouble now, but I thought I'd do that. Okay, at this time, Caleb has a little bit of an announcement here. Caleb, you're going to have to come up here and give it, because you got to be on microphone on this. And that is, as you know, we always say Caleb and Abigail are expecting in November. Well, really, Abigail's expecting in November, but they have named the baby. So get your pen and pencil out so you can write this down. Go ahead, Caleb.
The child's name is Liam James Miller.
It's a boy.
Okay. It is a boy. Congratulations to them. So, Abigail already knew that. The boy's kicking the stuffing out of her. So, anyway, congratulations to you folks. As you know, things continue to progress on, and we're certainly grateful for that. Looking in the bulletin, let me make mention of a few things that are going on. Again, this is our week where we have two care center ministries. We have Subtle Care 3:30 on Tuesday. We have Mackay Creek 12:30 on Thursday. And so I want you to know that these items are going on. To our church membership, we do have a quarterly congregational meeting. That will be on Wednesday. As you know, these meetings are always very important. Be very happy to have you there. And then I want you to look at Saturday here. Saturday, we have listed soul winning at 10 a.m. I want you to adjust your calendars here a little bit. It's not going to be at 10. We are going to be loading one of the church shuttles at 9:30 a.m. Men will still have men's prayer and coffee. We just don't get a gab quite as much. But we are loading the shuttle at 9:30 because we are doing a Pilot Rock outreach event. And so we are headed to Andrew Goodman's territory. He has been knocking literally almost the entire town of Pilot Rock since he's been here. And he's going to have maps for us and guide us. But that'll be on Saturday again. That'll be at 9:30. Remember, 1 week from today, Sunday night, we have Faith Bible Institute graduation. And we do have two graduates. And so I want you to be sure, be faithful, and attend that as well. So I want to make mention of these. Let me make mention also of two very, very specific needs in the church. Now, for those of you who are saying, do we need to give more to the Camp Scholarship Fund? I've been asked that a few times this week. The answer is no. There's enough funds in the Camp Scholarship Fund, but thank you for asking. We do have two needs here. Need number one, front and center, and that is a 15-passenger church van. And I'm happy to report we have located the van that we want. And a good brother in the Lord actually did what was necessary to reserve that van in the Portland area so it didn't get taken away from us. And so there's several different things we can do. We're about $4,000 short in our budget to purchase the van, and there may be some things we can do at the business meeting. But if for some reason God would put on your heart, you say, I want to give to that, then just simply put a van somewhere on a tithe envelope and that'll be fine. There is another big, big need, and that is our church roof. And we're looking at everything that's going on around us. How many of you have experienced inflation? You're experiencing it now. We're all experiencing it now. Now, you'd be happy to know that there's some people in government that says it doesn't really exist. Does that make you feel better? No. And they say you're not feeling the pain of it. So does that help you?
No.
Do I need to buy you some ruby red slippers and just click your heels three times? And the reality is, but because of that, we're literally in a time is of the essence scenario. We need $11,000 worth of building materials, and we need to get those building materials before the end of the month, or they will go up 12.5% next month. And this is what we're facing. And so you may go, Pastor, well, we need a miracle. I go, you're absolutely right. We do need a miracle. And to go, well, how do we get a miracle? You pray for it. If you didn't pray for it, it wouldn't be a miracle. So you pray for the miracle. Next Sunday, we will have an offering. And we will have an offering for our church roof. And just put in, church roof on whatever it is. Goes, what am I looking for? I'm looking for willing hearts. I'm not coming to your house. I'm not shaking you down. I'm just looking, say, you ask God, God, what would you have me to do at this particular thing with the needs presented? And you do what God tells you to do. And we see what God does. And so I want you to pray about that. Again, that'll be a special offering. That will be next Sunday. So please be in prayer for that. A lot of exciting things are going on here. At the end of the month, Pastor Greg Boyle from Faith Baptist Church in Spokane is going to speak. That Sunday night, Brother Andrew Goodman is going to speak, and that is his last Sunday here, only two Sundays away. There have been major conspiracies discussed. We've discussed everything from letting air out of his tires to tearing up his plane tickets and things like that. And Jim suggests breaking legs. I didn't realize he is part Italian. I don't know what that's about. But anyway, just want to let you know it's certainly not boring here. It's such an exciting and wonderful place to be. And I'm glad you're here with us to experience it together with us. Be in prayer for the children who are going to camp. There's 20 of us loading a van and a shuttle headed to camp 1 week from tomorrow. Go, Pastor, what do we pray? Pray that everybody who packs remembers what they're supposed to pack. That's always kind of a big, big thing. And if you have any questions, if your child is going to camp and you have any questions, be sure to talk to me. Be sure to talk to Mrs. Watkins about that. So at this time, we're going to receive our Sunday morning offering opportunity that we have to give of our tithes and offerings. As the ushers are coming forward, I want you to know Preachers Roundup is coming up the 19th and 20th of September. I sent out a text feeler, had some immediate response from some pastors in the area, including one pastor who says, well, I know you had a men's chili cook-off. Can we participate? And so I didn't know they were interested. But so anyway, some of the pastors coming, they're bringing their chili with them. And so that's okay. They'll give Mick a run for his money. I think 11 rattlesnakes and camping, counting, that's going to be a meaty chili. So we're going to have a wonderful time. That's taking place. Be in prayer for Jared Reagan. He is still in basic, called just as church was beginning today. He hasn't figured out the time zone change. But anyway, just be in prayer for him as he has just a few more weeks left for that. So let's have a word of prayer together. I'm going to ask Bob Johnson. Bob, if you would bless the offering, please. As each Sunday we've been talking about our theme, We Preach Christ and We Have a Moment. Many of the times I talk about the missionaries in the area. I want you to make a point to pray for our missionary in Togo, West Africa. The reason I call my missionary in Togo, West Africa is because otherwise you're going to have to say the name. His name is Brother Poisowe Patala. Okay, maybe if you say that 10 times and then say the lion sleeps tonight at the end, you might get it. But anyway, I want you to pray for him because Christian persecution has increased manyfold in that country. The government has used COVID as an excuse to change government regulations and clamp down on churches, eliminate, they allow Sunday morning service, but eliminate Sunday night service, eliminate street preaching and door to door. And Brother Puisque is doing everything he can to work his way around that. Does that sound familiar to you? Does it sound familiar to anyone? And you go, wouldn't it be great when COVID is over? And I'll say, well, I hate to tell you this, but as soon as you think it's over, they will discover a new subvariant. And we just have this reality. Who knew that no germs existed in the United States of America before COVID? And so, but anyway, I want you to pray for them because of the persecution. And ISIS is invading the north part of the country, and they're indiscriminately killing the citizens of Togo. And so that country needs a lot of prayer, so please remember them, if you would. At this time, we're going to sing one more song. It's Good to Be on the Winning Side, number 341. Brother Jim.
All right, let's all stand before the message, number 341, Victory in Jesus. Amen. 341, sing out now. I heard an old story, our Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin, won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me, sold with his redeeming blood. Praise God! I knew him and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and cause the blind to see. Then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me, sold with his redeeming blood. Praise God! Loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard
Junior Church, you are dismissed.
He's built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet amen song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me, sold his redeeming blood. Praise God! Loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath his cleansing flood.
Amen. wonderful singing. Please find your Bibles and turn to the book of James. The book of James, if you do not have a Bible. In the middle of the pew, there's a Bible, and you can use that one. And it'll be the book of James, chapter 3. Make mention of a couple other things going on here. That is, if you look at our church bulletin board, you will see there's an invitation for a birthday celebration held here at the church, 1 p.m. Saturday, July 30th, for a tall man who's a half a century old, okay? And I really can't disclose the name of that man, but his initials are Mark Niederwerfer. Oh, wait, I mean, yeah, so anyway, you know that. And so just anyway, letting you know that that is happening. I am so glad. I don't know who was the person who came up with the great idea that they have parties and serve food for people that grow older. You know, it's a, you know, it's all downhill, but we get food anyway. And so that's a wonderful thing. So James chapter 3, looking at verse 13 this morning, please look along with me as we look at these very, very important verses in the Word of God. James 3, starting at verse 13. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Let us have a word of prayer together. Dear Heavenly Father, let every word of your holy word sink into our hearts today. Because when it comes to authority, you are the authority. When it comes to teaching, you are the teacher. When it comes to wisdom, you are the wiser. And when it comes to spiritual debt, you are the helper. And so I pray that you would help us as we look carefully into your word this morning, and that you would work to do a transforming work in our lives, because we decide together that we will let you do so. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Sometimes people might think that being the pastor of a church is exciting. But could there ever have been a church more exciting than the first church, the first called out assembly that ever existed? Could there have been a place more exciting than the First Baptist Church of Jerusalem? And you go, well, why do you call it a Baptist church? Well, the Bible says they that gladly received his word were baptized. So I will just go out on a limb and say it was a Baptist church. They baptized. But what an exciting thing. And not only would the church be exciting, all these new converts, but don't you think that being the pastor of that church would be just so amazingly exciting? And you look at that and you think of just all the excitement that would take place, and you would say that is exciting. And then you would think of all the commotion and problems that would take place, and you would go, yeah, An older, wiser pastor told me this when I was quite young. He said, a church is full of people, and people are full of problems. So let me ask you that question, right? Let me ask this question. How many of you came today and you said, you know what? This week, I've had some problems. Anybody had some problems? See, look at this. So many honest people. You know, problems are something part of everyday life. A church is full of people, and people are full of problems. There's a man. His name is James. James is the man whom God used to write the book bearing his name. He was a half-brother of Jesus Christ. What does this mean? It means this. Jesus, of course, was born of God through Mary. But James was born of Joseph and Mary. And he didn't believe in Jesus at the first. But he believed in Jesus Christ, that Jesus was who he said he was, the holy begotten Son of God, after his resurrection. Now, if the book itself, the book of James, were to give any clues, how did James get saved? It would appear that it was the actions of Jesus Christ that made a believer out of James. Some people believed Jesus because what he said, and they believed him because he said it. Other people believed in Jesus Christ and the Scripture's authority because of what he did and how he did it. And so I believe in many ways this shaped the man who became the pastor of the First Baptist Church of Jerusalem. You know, indeed, James is a book that promotes the importance of observed Christianity, as emphasized by things that he said in the book of James, like, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, or faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. It means you can't have faith unless there are works that are attached to it, because works are the product of a real faith. By the way, this is not a teaching that is foreign to Christ's teachings himself, who said, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? So James became a pastor. In fact, this is actually the only book of the Bible through the power of the Holy Spirit that was written by a person who was actively pastoring a church at the time the book was written. And he was a watcher, as pastors very often are watchers. And in this passage, an observation is made. There are common things that cause chaos, even among God's people. And there are things which cause harmony, even among God's people. We therefore find that in this passage, an active choice is brought about by inward character. And so what we find in this passage is a crossroads between two things. And this is the title of the message: confusion or clarity? Confusion or clarity? And because there are two things to look at here, I can tell you this is a two-point message. And if that means you think this message will be really, really short, you are so sadly mistaken. But it does mean there are two things, main processes, that you need to keep in mind as we look at this. And first, we're going to reread James chapter 3, verses 14 through 16, which is dealing with the part that deals with confusion. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual,
devilish, for where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. So, first point is this. I want you to think about this. Confusion is brought about by conflict. I want you to think about this. Confusion is brought about by conflict. And soon we'll get to the source of the conflict, but first we're going to talk, what is the weapon of the conflict? And the interesting thing is, since we are already in James chapter 3, the Bible in the book of James has already identified the weapon of the conflict that could create chaos in the church. Look with me at verse 8. And it says this, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. And so what we have here is we have the weapon that can cause chaos in the church, and it is the tongue. Now, I am not a fan of tongues anyway, except for the fact I have one and I have to use it to preach. But a long, long time ago, somebody tried to offer to serve me for a meal cow's tongue. And for some reason, I was just instinctively repulsed by the idea that they're going to cook something with taste buds all over it and feed it to me. And I didn't understand really why it bothered me until my high school classmate, who was also a fellow born-again believer, said, well, it's really, really easy. Why in the world would you want to taste something that's tasting you back? And I went, okay, that makes perfect sense. And so it looked at this, but here what we have is we have a weapon of conflict that's already identified that can cause chaos in a church, and it's called the tongue. Now that's the weapon. That's not the source. The source of the conflict is two different heart problems that are identified here in the scripture. In fact, the very, very first term is called, but if ye have bitter envying, and the other one is called strife. So we'll get to item number one here, and item number one is envy. And you go, well, what is envy? And we sometimes will use a different term. We'll use the term jealousy, bowing down to the green-eyed God. I don't know who started jealousy as being green-eyed. I have no idea. But we have this reality here, and jealousy is a source, a heart source of chaos in the world, but yes, even in the church of God. Well, what kind of envy can there be? Well, how about this one? A jealous of a sibling. Jealous of a sibling could be another sibling's acceptance. It could be another sibling's, jealous of another sibling's attention. Somebody giving that sibling attention. Jealousy of another sibling's performance. We have a couple examples, by the way. Anybody ever heard of Cain and Abel? That was a jealousy thing. What happened? Abel was accepted. Cain was not. What did Cain do? Said, I'll take care of this. I'll eliminate the competition. Okay? It was envy. It was a heart issue. How about Joseph? Anybody hear about Joseph? You know, Joseph. And in that case, they were jealous of the father's attention toward Joseph. And they thought, well, this is easy. We'll just get rid of the competition. We'll send him down the cistern. We'll sell him into slavery. And that way we can all buy hamburgers on the way back home. I mean, so we had all these things that were going on here. By the way, people are not immune to envy. I don't remember this, but I guess as a small child, I was very, very envious. Now cut me some slack. I didn't receive Christ until I was 8 years old. And by the way, I am proof positive that when I go knocking door to door and I say to somebody, have you received Christ as their personal Savior? And they said, well, I've always known him. I can tell you that doesn't cut it. Nobody has always known God. I am proof positive that you don't always know God when you're a small child. I mean, I was the third out of four. Guess what that means? Number four came in the door. And when number four came in the door, wrapped in a little bundle with my mom, and they came in the door, I said what any practical, pragmatic older brother would say, "Did you get him from the store?" I literally said that. I think the insinuation is, can you send him back? Okay? And remember that before my younger brother came, all my toys around me were only toys, but after my younger brother came, I discovered toys could be weapons also. And all of a sudden, my mom had to become my younger brother's bodyguard. And see, now the good news is I have no memory of that. That was all before Christ. That's all under the blood. But there's somebody to always tell me the story. But understand, envy is being jealous of a sibling's acceptance, attention, or performance. Does envy exist in a church family? Oh, yeah. In this case, it could be jealous of another's relationship or jealous of another's ministry or jealous of another's position or jealous of another's performance or jealous of another's recognition. Look with me just briefly. You can stay in James if you want, but others if you want. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6. And different than James being a pastor, Timothy was young in the ministry and being trained how to be in the ministry, which makes 1 Timothy a very important book for people who are going into the pastorate. And he said, he's a warning to Timothy. Timothy, you're going to find some people in your church like this. From which some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. Well, what would make somebody who's not a teacher want to be a teacher when they don't know anything and God hasn't gifted them and they couldn't teach or speak their way out of a wet paper sack? And it's a very simple word. It's called jealousy. No, I noticed that once upon a time, a Sunday school teacher got a little piece of paper that said, "Thank you for teaching Sunday school." Go, "I want one of those. Can I teach? Not on your life. But I want the paper." And sometimes it's just as simple as that. Just wanting the attention. Jealous of another's relationship or ministry or position or performance or recognition. Anybody ever heard of jealousy at school? Okay? Anybody ever heard the term teacher's pet? Well, the term teacher's pet has a lot to do with envy. Or how about brainiac? Okay? That has a lot to do with envy by those who are maybe a little less brainiac. And so there's things like that. Has there been any of you in the regular workaday world feel? Okay? Jessica, you work in the office sometimes, don't you? Do you believe that your life is a living, breathing Dilbert cartoon? It's something to think about. And the thing is, it's important to understand that, and that is one of the common things that happen in jobs, getting passed over. Okay, you know, you're the one who's been working there 20 years. No, some young pup gets in there, works 6 months. All of a sudden, they become your supervisor. How fun is that? And so, but envy, there can be envy in the workplace. How about a husband and wife? Could a wife actually be envious of a husband? Or could a husband actually be envious of a wife? Happens. Mrs. Watkins and I, we've been in a few different churches. One experience we had, we were in a church where the husband was a professional Finnish carpenter. And the wife was, you guessed it, a professional Finnish carpenter. And they were jealous of each other and constantly competing with each other. Let's just say it was not a warm and harmonious relationship. When I was growing up in my college days, I ran into a husband and wife, and they were both horticulturists. And all they did for 40 to 50 years is fight with one another over who knew the right way to prune a bush. True story. Sometimes it's simpler than that. It's just envy over another person's things. Another person's car, another person's house, another person's dishes. Whereas the Bible says in the Old Testament, another person's spouse. So it's important to understand this, and that is, and so what happens? Well, what happens is there becomes this chaos, this confusing opposition. As the scripture describes, where it things like, backbiting, or gossip, or criticism, or just this just seemingly unreasonable opposition. So James, remember who he is. He's a pastor of a church. What does he do? He watches. What did he see? This. By the way, does anybody know one of the reasons why Jesus was crucified? Other than the fact that it was always God's divine plan. But why did the Pharisees want him dead? Matthew 27, verse 17 says this, "Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, Who will ye that I release unto you? Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he knew," he had eyes too, "he knew that for envy they had delivered him." Have you ever had a friend, maybe somebody outside a church, and then all of a sudden they suddenly, inexplicably turned on you and rejected you? And you'd been nothing but kind to them all their lives. But what happened is you received Christ, and Christ changed you. And they were not changed. And this little thing called envy showed up. Confusion or clarity. Now, one of them is envy, but the other one is, and it is in there as an additional thing in James chapter 3, and it says this, "But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts." What's strife? Just commotion. Just commotion. And the thing is, it's just literally being at odds. It's just literally being against. I mean, strife can be caused by arguments over even things that are unknown and unknowable by somebody who just wants to appear they know something. The Bible says in Titus chapter 3, verse 9, "But avoid foolish questions and genealogies and contentions and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain." It's like saying, okay, do angels have long hair or short hair? Okay? Or how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? Okay? You know, what does heaven actually look like? And you know, and you just go in and then says, well, I think it looks like this. No, I think it looks like that. And people get into crazy arguments about things they don't know about, nor can they know it. Because God has told us a lot of things, but he hasn't told us everything. All he is saying is, "I have not seen nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for those who love him." There's things that we cannot know. Some people argue about the unknown and the unknowable. It's called strife. Some people just debate to be contrary. Anybody know somebody like that? Somebody who just likes to argue because, no other reason, they just like to argue. Anybody know somebody like that? Don't name them, just tell me if you know somebody like that. Okay? Okay? Yeah. Just tell me something like that. And if you're married to somebody like that, do not say anything at this point. But I'm here to tell you, some people just are that way. And the Bible talks in Romans chapter 1, verse 29, and it talks on the bottom floor, the tail end of the downward spiral of depravity, debates is one of the things it says. They just like to argue because they like to argue because they like to argue. They just like conflict. They just like shouting. They just like chaos. They debate just to be contrary. And then, you know, one of the things, by the way, if you look in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 3, where you get the list of somebody who you may consider to be a pastor, here's what it says. It says, not given to wine, of course, but no striker. Do you think that's maybe important that you don't go up to the pastor and he doesn't go, bap? He's a Baptist, but not supposed to do that. Okay. No striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler. Doesn't get into fisticuffs. My wife and I had the opportunity to be involved in a ministry that was 113 years old in Montana. And our board meetings were comparatively peaceful. What do you mean by comparatively? Well, people in the church told me stories about how years before there were fisticuffs in the business meetings. That's not very peaceful. Strife is being at odds, against arguments, debating, contentions. And then it says, what is the inner source of conflict? And it's described here. Look with me at verse 15 of James chapter 3. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but there's these three things here. It says, it's earthly. What does earthly mean? Earthly means it's the adoption of a worldly mindset, not a spiritual mindset. The Bible says, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not from the Father, but is of the world. So it's earthly, the adoption of a worldly mindset. Then the second, it says, it's sensual. What does the concept sensual mean? It's an addiction to the flesh. Think of it that way. It's not just in the flesh. It's an addiction to the flesh. This is, by the way, where James, remember, he was the watching pastor, said in James 4:1, from whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lusts that war in your members? It didn't say that it's a battle on the outside. It's a battle, it's a war on the inside of an individual. And then the third one, and this is maybe the scariest of all, devilish. Remember, he's talking in the context of a church. And he says devilish. And what that means is literally activity that exists in the demonic realm. Sometimes people say, well, I go to church to get away from the devil. I go, well, that's kind of interesting. The devil goes to church every Sunday. What do you think the devil's going to do on Sunday? He goes to church. I think there's probably a demon assigned to every good Bible preaching church because the devil wants to stir things up. No, I always have a harder time in the summer. You know why? Because during the regular months, churches are more active. You get to the summer, a lot of churches go on summer break. They cancel Sunday school, and they cancel this, and they cancel their Bible studies, they cancel their meetings, and they cancel that. Then you've got a demon going, nothing to do here, what will I do? I think I'll go to Berean Baptist Church. And that happens. And so you got that activity in the demonic realm. In verse 12 of Ephesians chapter 6, this is important. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And so we're dealing with the inner source of conflict. We looked in the mirror, we are looking for the enemy, and it are us. Because it comes from the inside, not the outside. Okay. Okay, that's it. All the time I've got. Sermon over, you're dismissed. No, I'm not going to do that to you. Here's the important thing. We dealt with the first point. I'll be happy to tell you the second point in theory, shorter. And that is, confusion is brought about by conflict, but clarity is brought about by character. Back in the book of James, chapter 3, look at verse 13. It says this, "Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation," this means a good lifestyle, "his works with meekness of wisdom." Understand, clarity is brought about by character. One, it is evidenced by a righteous lifestyle. A righteous lifestyle is where if somebody is looking, they see that there's a peacefulness that is brought about by a righteous lifestyle. And one of the telltale signs is this concept, meekness of wisdom. And meekness, by the way, is an old English word that talks about being of a gentle spirit. A gentle spirit. And so it's evidenced by a righteous lifestyle, but then heavenly wisdom displays character. Look with me at verse 17. Because we have a list here, and as we go through that list, about half the items on the list, you could actually, if you want to, cross-reference with the Beatitudes of Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 5. Because it starts by saying this, looking here, "But wisdom that is from above is first pure." Oh, really? There's a verse for that. "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." And then it's peaceable. Oh, really? There's a verse for that. "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." And then it is gentle. Oh, there's a verse for that. "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." And so it has that, and it goes on. It says pure, then peaceable, gentle. Then this other phrase, easy to be entreated. It means approachable. It means somebody will come to you and talk to you because they sense in their spirit you're not going to chop their head off for asking you a question. Easy to be entreated. It's that character. It's approachable. And then it also uses this term here. It says full of mercy. Oh, interesting. Matthew 5:7, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." So we're dealing with character here. And then we're dealing with this idea also. It says full of mercy and good fruits. Understand, good fruits in the Christian life can only come through Jesus Christ. Can't come through anything else. Certainly can't come through us. Only through Jesus Christ, who said, "I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing." One of the greatest failures in God's church is a bunch of believers trying to do something to God without complete and utter dependence on the person of Jesus Christ. So guess what happens? A lot of nothing. But with Jesus, there can be something. And then also this term, without partiality, being impartial. By the way, James, the observing pastor, talked about that. He said this, "But if in James 2:9, but if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin." In other words, we treat everybody the same. Impartial. And then there's this phrase, which I really like, and that is without hypocrisy. And what without hypocrisy means, the real meal deal. That's what it means. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 6 speaks about this, where it says this. It says, "By pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost." Here it is, "by love unfeigned." It means real love, not phony baloney. Not the Southern, "bless their black little heart." Oh, it's by the real thing. Love unfeigned, the real meal deal. By the way, you can't get real love apart from God. People have been trying for centuries and millennia. There's no real love apart from God. It's genuine. And then verse 18 says, here's the result. And the fruit of righteousness is sown of peace of them that make peace. It's a peaceful gathering. It's a peaceful gathering caused by people who have gathered their wisdom from above instead of below. So let me close, because here's the thing. The difference between chaos and clarity in a church is an inside story. Three things and we're done here. Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 14. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 14. First is this amount, this clarity in our minds, and that is we serve a God of order. It's peaceful in heaven. Just thought I'd let you know. God wants churches to be a piece of heaven on earth. The Bible says this, two verses here. One is verse 33, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. That tells us what God is in charge of and what God is bringing about. And verse 40, let everything be done decently and in order. And then also this, it's who we beseech when we're in trouble. When we're in trouble inside. And let me tell you something. If a person is not peaceful inside, they will not be peaceful outside. They've got to be peaceful inside. Well, where does that peace come from? Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And then, what about if we're the best, or we're at our best? You know, some people are good at things, and other people are the best at things. What does God expect of people that are good at things, or are the best at things? It's found in verse 10 of James chapter 4. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Really doesn't matter how good I am at anything. There is a God who's better. And I need his help. You know, if there's ever a time I'm tempted to think I'm something, then I have this comparison thing with Almighty God. And I realize what Jesus said. He says, apart from me, ye can do nothing. In fact, it says, if a man think himself to be something, when he is nothing as yet what he ought to be. God expects humility in the best. Because humility is the pathway to peace. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll extend an invitation. As we are praying right now, I'm going to ask this. Are you at peace inside? Inside. That can only come from a relationship with Jesus Christ. And apart from salvation, it's not going to happen at all. We need God's help if we're going to be what we need to be. And if you're even a little unsure about your eternal destiny, even a little unsure, that is a very, very bad sign. But God wants to take care of that. God wants you to be sure of your spiritual destiny. God wants you to be sure if you died, you go to heaven. And that is who God is. He loves you. He's the God of help. He's the God of strength. He's the God of peace. And even as born-again believers, we have our times. We have our moments. And God wants to help you at your time of need.
Dear Heavenly Father, please use your word in our hearts today. And we come before you acknowledging the issue is just that. The issue is our hearts. So we ask that you would help us. We ask that you would change us. Because we know you're the only one who really can. And we pray that you would help us to move forward together for you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand together, the song is number 534. This particular hymn, we'll stand as we sing. This particular hymn is a hymn of introspection. And it is taken from Psalm 139. King David asked God to search his heart to see what he was really like and then to lead him in the way everlasting. The altar is open. If you have a need, you can come while we sing this song, number 534.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray.
People praying. This is a time for you to let God meet the need of your heart and the need of your person. If you have a prayer need and you want somebody to pray with you, you can take them up here to an old-fashioned altar and pray together. Or if you want me to pray with you, I certainly can have a word of prayer with you at this time. We live a life of need, but God is in the business of meeting needs. And he wants to help you right now. He doesn't want to wait, doesn't have to wait. And if he doesn't have to wait, you don't have to wait. He can help you. This is your time. Would you come? Would you come? Let's sing this last verse together.
Oh, Holy Ghost, revival comes from thee.